My name is Tom Wolfe. I was a scientist with Agriculture Canada for about 17 years, specializing in spray technology. I now head my own company called Agrimetrics Research and Training, and we conduct research and training in spraying. Well, the single most important thing about spraying is to know your spray quality, that is the droplet size that your nozzles are producing. Spray quality determines the coverage and the effectiveness of most pesticides. It also determines the spray drift you receive from the pesticides. The sprayer nozzle manufacturers publish the spray qualities of their nozzles at all the different pressures under which they're supposed to operate. So it's fairly straightforward for a producer to take a look at the nozzle that they own and understand what spray quality they produce and make adjustments either with pressure or with a different nozzle selection to achieve the spray quality that they need to do the job right. Most of the chemical companies do not advise their clients very well what spray quality they should be using. They simply say use a flat fan nozzle and use it at 40 psi, or you know, use it in 100 liters per hectare of water, or something like that, some fairly general statements. But in today's modern spray nozzle world, we are capable of producing a very wide variety of spray qualities, ranging from fine, medium, coarse, to very coarse, extremely coarse, and ultra coarse now. And there's a justifiably a lot of confusion about what the right spray quality is. So the initial solution is simply to aim about for the middle as a starting point, and that is a coarse spray. So a general purpose spray would be coarse, and then we deviate from that according to our needs. So for example, if it's a contact product that's being sprayed, contact herbicide, that might require more coverage and therefore smaller droplets, we would simply increase our spray pressure to try to achieve something that is more of a medium spray quality. If it's a systemic product or we have a higher water volume, then we can deviate into drift control and go to maybe a very coarse spray quality. And pressure really is the tool that we use to alter the spray quality of a specific nozzle that we already have. Most modern sprayers are equipped with a rate controller that makes sure that the rate per hectare is the same throughout the field, regardless of the travel speed that the sprayer is running at. So for example, if the sprayer speeds up, then a higher flow rate of liquid is required for the same amount of product to be applied per hectare. The rate controller takes care of that by changing the flow through a pressure change. So higher travel speed means a higher pressure, and therefore a higher flow rate. So most of the applicators don't pay much attention to the pressure that their sprayer is operating. They allow the rate controller to make that selection automatically. They simply select the right speed. But I think we have it backwards. What an applicator should be doing is to prominently place the spray pressure gauge in his or her field of view, and then adjust the travel speed until the correct spray pressure is reached. Because again, it's the spray pressure that determines the spray quality, the pattern uniformity, a lot of other characteristics that are important to the sprayer. So that the spray pressure gauge is actually your speedometer. We are going to be seeing, possibly in 2014, Enlist on the market with a tank mix of glyphosate and Dow's new 240 formulation, 240 choline. Now that formulation is a low drift formulation, and yet they still say that it should be applied with a coarse, very coarse, extremely coarse kind of spray. They have done research to validate that it will work well at those coarser spray qualities. And we've independently also worked not with 2,4-D choline, but with other forms of 2,4-D, and shown that it does indeed work quite well at larger droplet sizes, coarser spray qualities. So I suspect it'll work quite well in those coarser sprays. But the key thing is that the company has to stand behind that. If they make the recommendation, then they ought to be able to, they ought to have the data that shows that it will work, and I think that they do. Monsanto's Xtend technology is the same. With dicamba, again, there are concerns about spray drift, and they've advocated for extremely coarse, even ultra coarse sprays. which are really pushing the boundary in terms of droplet size. It's larger than what we've tended to use in agriculture. Again, they have the data set that supports that kind of a spray quality. I think the big adjustment for most applicators is that glyphosate typically is applied in fairly low water volumes. So we've always known that it works quite well at 50 or 60 liters per hectare, sometimes less. With this kind of a spray quality, we will likely be going to higher water volumes with glyphosate, and that's a new thing we have to learn. So probably closer to 100 liters per hectare will be required for that coarse spray to be efficacious. Travel speed is a really popular productivity tool. Most applicators love going faster because they can do more acres per hour and get more done in a day, and the window opportunity is always very small. On the other hand, travel speed brings with it some problems. It creates a greater likelihood of drift. More small droplets become disentrained from the spray cloud, get pulled out, and they predispose themselves to drift by just hanging basically in the air behind the sprayer. The pattern uniformity may be affected as well with a higher travel speed. We have also wheel tracks, and overall sort of disruption of the airflow by the sprayer itself becomes more severe. So these are the kinds of problems that are difficult to solve with a different nozzle or a different water volume. They're just an artifact of going fast. So I'm not a big fan of fast travel speeds. I'd rather allow or look for other opportunities for being productive, such as faster tank fill times perhaps, maybe a wider boom, those kinds of strategies, other efficiencies. On the other hand, I think it's inevitable that producers will travel faster. The sprayers are better than ever, better suspension systems, more horsepower, more operator comfort, more rate control, better rate control all the time. So it's possible to go fast, and people will go fast. I think what I'd like to do is put the ball back in the manufacturer's court and say, please design a spray boom that is aerodynamically suited for fast travel speeds. Please design a spray chassis that is aerodynamic. Please design nozzles that create patterns that are well suited to fast travel speeds. Because right now, all of our hardware is still designed for a conventional slow speed. The data has not changed. And when we get to 15 and 20 and even 25 miles per hour travel speed, that won't be adequate anymore. Boom height is a big one. I mean, boom height is, for example, a very important way of managing spray drift. Low booms are very effective at reducing drift. One of the problems has been recently that our booms are getting wider, and although the suspension system has been getting more sophisticated as well, our boom heights have tended to be higher because the booms have gotten wider. But more recently now, this is to prevent the boom from hitting the ground. More recently now, we have automatic boom height controllers that sense the location of the boom, make adjustments to the hydraulics, and keep the boom level and low. Those are a very good thing, and that is allowing us now to look at boom height again as a best management practice. Low booms work better in a number of situations. I already mentioned drift, but they also increase canopy penetration, and they increase the effectiveness of an angled spray. So if you look at a twin fan, or even just a forward or backward facing nozzle, that kind of an adjustment really gets traction with a low boom height. With a high boom height, the effect is virtually lost. The sprays are deflected in the oncoming headwind from this travel speed. They become just a passive cloud before they hit the canopy, and the whole idea of a twin fan nozzle is lost at a high boom height. So the low boom is an important management strategy to take advantage of those new nozzles. Most producers want to be sure that the $10, $20, or $30 they're spending per acre is going to work for them. It's a significant expenditure. The very first step is to consult with the manufacturer, either through the label or in person, and understand completely the right water volume and the right spray quality that is recommended for that active ingredient. The manufacturers usually can help in that regard. Once you have an idea about what's needed, you need to consult the nozzle manufacturer and find out, well, which nozzle and what pressure produces the required spray quality and water volume. So that's just a look up in the catalog. But finally, I think when you get out into the field and you try something new for the first time, you ought to have some kind of assurance that what you're doing is going to work. A good tool is water-sensitive paper. These are little cards. They usually measure about 5 by 7 centimeters or so. And the yellow surface turns blue when water hits it. They're available for purchase and are a very good quality assessment tool. You lay them down on the ground, make a spray pass as you ordinarily would, and then have a look at them and look at sort of the droplet density, the droplet size, and compare them to some standards that you have of what you've done in the past or what you expect to should happen. And then make adjustments. If the spray droplet density is not enough, you might want to increase your spray pressure, produce more small droplets. You may want to change your water volume. You make those kinds of adjustments prior to committing to spraying a whole field with a new tank. So an important part of spraying is actually that air often gets introduced into the boom by accident, but it's a normal part of the spraying process. Air disrupts the accuracy of your rate controller. It introduces a lag. It delays the shutoff of the nozzles when you reach the end of the field. It delays the resumption of spraying when you turn them back on. It also, modern spray booms also have a reservoir at the end of the last nozzle where, you know, residue and contaminating chemicals can build up and contaminate a future field that might be sensitive to that chemical. The traditional way of bleeding is to open a valve at the end of each boom section, at each end of the boom section. But a new way is to retrofit the booms with something called the Express Nozzle Body End Cap, which is available from Hypro. It automatically bleeds the air out of the boom on the go. It also automatically has a terminal end that does not accumulate any reservoir. So it's a fairly simple retrofit. Anyone can do it at home, in their shop, and basically eliminate the air for booms on an ongoing basis. And that will improve the operation of the rate controller as well. So better responsiveness, faster shutoff, more reliable turn on as well. It's immediate turn on basically. So even though we have very sophisticated liquid delivery systems, there's really no way for the applicator to be certain that the nozzles are putting out the required, the proper amount of liquid. It's basically faith in the nozzle manufacturer that the nozzle is working as advertised. We have monitors that measure the total flow of the liquid to the boom, but they cannot measure the flow to the individual nozzles. So the only way in 2014 that a Ontario producer has to be sure that the sprayer is properly calibrated is to take a graduated cylinder and hold it for 30 seconds under each and every nozzle. That's exactly the same way we did it in 1945. Exactly the same way. And you know, there's opportunity now for, I guess, aftermarket as well for better calibration procedures. So there's now a company in Saskatoon called Agritronics, and they make a jug that can determine the flow rate of the nozzle electronically, and you just have to hold it under the sprayer for a time until the reading settles, and you press enter and you dump it out and you repeat. It stores all the numbers. You can download them through a USB connector, and then you have a record of the output of each individual nozzle on your sprayer. You can go back to that later. And so now that has added a certain level of sophistication and ease of use to the calibration process. But you still have to do it. And that's the problem. You still have to do it. And most producers turn their sprayer on, have a little look, everything's spraying, that's good. And then they dial in the 10 gallons per acre, and they go, and they trust it all as well. And it sometimes isn't.